a la Universidad de Stuttgart. He was, before the university, in the research and the industry. He's an experienced manager in the industry. And now he's docent in research at the University of Stuttgart. Professor Caro, he is a very good knower of our old history of Cartagena. He now very good the history of the Cartagena people. He was for me a surprise when he told me that he know about the he understands too Spanish. O sea que yo estoy aquí haciendo ahora un poco de esfuerzo para traducirme al inglés y él entiende español, y más en castellano, que es bastante bueno. Entonces, él hoy nos va a hablar de un tema aplicado a su campo de investigación, ¿verdad?, que es desde que hace ya casi medio siglo, ¿verdad? Yo lo leí una vez, me interesé, de las posibilidades de la nanotecnología, ya 50 años, no somos sé más diferente que yo. Pues desde entonces es un campo en el cual tiene multitud de aplicaciones, no solamente materiales, como las otras conferencias de hoy, sino multitud de campos, la medicina, la biología, de todo. Hoy el profesor Fitza, el subconsciente, el profesor Caro nos hablará de las aplicaciones del campo de la tecnología a las personas que trabajan actualmente en el campo de los revestimientos cerámicos, ¿verdad? Sobre todo pues, en lo que afecta también a su formación básica de procesos en la tecnología de procesos de aplicación. Como ya no me quiero extender más, me puede comentar.
Thank you very much for the kind invitation. It is my pleasure to come back again to the University of Politécnica of Cartagena. And before I start my talk, which was entitled Processing of Nanoceramic Materials and Coatings, let me just give you some general remarks. We have learned from so many publications the term of nanotechnologies. So many people think this is something brand new, something unknown, but for
this is very original since more than 100 years, because the dimensions where modern chemistry is acting is the world of nanometers. We have still the more traditional unit named after a Swedish scientist, Angström, which is just a tenth of a nanometer. So if we stay serious, nanotechnologies is absolutely something conventional. But there is a lot of beautiful perspectives, mainly in microtechnologies, and this means microelectronics, electronic devices with improved calculation capacity and speed, supercomputers, and also the storage devices. This will not be any subject of my talk, because my institute belongs to a department of mechanical engineering and industrial manufacturing. So I will bring you some information about the other important field, and this is the world of nanostructured materials. Nanostructured materials that play an important role in mechanical engineering, but since a couple of years also in the field of biomedical applications. That means materials that can be used for structural applications as well as in a machine or in a human body. And so this comes closer to what I will report you this morning. So my talk is divided in two subjects. One is to show you the principal ideas and strategies and results, how to create a new generation of high performance ceramics, massive ceramics, or. And the second field of application is coatings, surface technologies. And there is one easy reason why just the ceramist is so highly motivated to work with nanopowders. What can be the reason? Because nanoceramic powders have a very high chemical stability. If you imagine such powders can have a specific surface of more than 100 or even more than 200 square meters per gram. You can imagine what will happen with a metallurgical species. In just the contact with oxygen of the air and some thermal energy, it will start to burn or even to explode. This is a very simple reason why the ceramics are so far forward in the development of manufacturing technologies with nanomaterials, because of their unique stability, even if they are in nano size. Nanostructured ceramics were first reported in Japan. Our friend and colleague Koichi Nihara, he was for more than 25 years a professor in Osaka, and he was the first one who had not only access to the materials, but who was also working on some fundamental theoretical concepts, which I want to introduce to you in a minute. That means to have a good review or overview on this class of materials, it makes sense to separate the main four typologies of these ceramic nano or nanocomposite materials. The first one is the so-called intratype. Intratype means we have a conventional micro scale, that means micrometer size, primary grain size structure in the material, and we have a nano species as a dispersion in this micro sized structure. The second one, much more sophisticated from many points of view, is the intertype. Here we have again the conventional micrometer scale primary lattice, and by special technologies we have deposited the nanospheres along the grain boundaries, along the grain boundaries. So again, it is a two-phase or even a ternary phase material where the two phases each penetrate one another. And to get it more complex, we have the combination of both. We have the combination of both. Intra plus inter type. And what remains now is the most complicated structure from the viewpoint of a manufacturing engineer. That is the nano-nano type. That means at least the two species that are involved, both must be processed, must be handled, in the absolute nanometer size. And by definition of the scientific community in material science and engineering, this means primary particles in a size between 10 and 100 nanometers, not larger than 100 nanometers. And this is not only a theoretical concept, there is a clear strategy behind it, and there are many micro devices. Let me just give you an idea. If you have a beautiful inkjet printer today, a high-resolution inkjet printer, the little actuator who gives you the injection is made from such a generation of ceramics. That means very high strains, very high toughness, which is unusual for a ceramic material, and very high reliability. Reliability, long-term application. That means the outcome of these concepts is an improved material properties by the incorporation or even by the full manufacturing process based on nanoparticle in the submicron scale matrix materials. So the first results were published in the early 90s, and 2 years ago when Professor Nihara went to retirement, we had his emeritus celebration. All the people met in Osaka again, and we could see that these materials, they show distinctly improved hardness. Until recently, we thought hardness is an intrinsic material property. Yes, this is true, but only to a certain extent, as the hardness is strictly related to the chemical bond and to the crystal structure. But in modern technology, we do not work with single crystals, we are working with polycrystalline materials. And let me say, with the hardness, such a structure shows not only an improved hardness, it also shows an improved tenacity, and this means ductility, a property that was nearly unknown for the ceramics, and I will show you some specific results in a minute. This is only true if we can obtain a structure that is free of defects. Free of defects. And this makes it very clear how complicated is the development of completely new manufacturing chains. We cannot just adapt what we have done since 20, 30 years, use novel type of powder, and then we may wait what is the outcome. No, we need different technologies of the preparation of feedstocks, and especially the viscous behavior, the rheology. The behavior of the fluidized compounds play an important role. The second benefit is the distinctly improved abrasion resistance, the total mechanical strength. Such material can have 3 times, 4 times the strength of steel. If you look to a conventional ceramic, if it has 50% of the strength of steel, many people are happy. So we really change, it is like a change of paradigm in materials engineering. And there are further additional properties like the ability of superplasticity of the fourth group of the nanonanotype. And I will just show you which are the materials. What is the chemical composition, what is the crystal structure that is applied? A very important one is the combination of aluminum oxide and zirconium oxide. All these were binary or even more complex phases. And we have this type of ceramics in two compositions.
with the majority of the alumina. So where alumina is the matrix and zirconia is the dispersion and vice versa. So the short term is ZTA, zirconia toughened alumina, and ATZ, alumina toughened zirconia. And you may have a first idea that this may be a sensitive subject to the patent literature. Because since a couple of years we have protected know-how and all these recipes, all these combinations to the very details belong to somebody who has the intellectual property. Fortunately, we have our own patents and therefore we are able from the concept, from the idea, to the materials development, we can go to the final customer, to the final industrial application. But it is not only true for the oxide ceramics, it is also true for the non-oxide ceramics, like silicon nitride and silicon carbide. Or even quite exotic until a few years ago, the combination of an oxide ceramic with a nano non-oxide dispersion. In this case, an alumina matrix with silicon carbide nano dispersions. And as I will not go in so much details for this material, just to give you one idea, this is the most creep resistant material ever reported in the scientific literature or tested in the technical system. You know, creep is the mechanical deformation under long-term load, not just high cycle fatigue and short application periods, but to work, for example, in special furnaces or in a nuclear fission power plant with a long, long, many months or years high temperature exposition. And this shows why this class of new materials is so interesting, in their final properties for various applications. Another example is the boron carbide with a titanium borite dispersion. This material has a toughness that is superior to the steel of Prusados. Yeah? That means heavy armor for heavy artillery, so you can withstand even a tungsten bullet with such a material as a protection. And since a couple of years, for the high-ranking specialists, we have protective personal vests and such equipment in Afghanistan, for example, yet in the application. So you see, this is a very broad range of applications where these materials can be used in an advantageous way. The challenge for the manufacturing engineer is much more than just the set of requirements for the material scientist. If the material scientist can create a little sample, which is enough to make a beautiful characterization, you just need an electron microscope or an X-ray analyzer, and so you can determine crystal structure, microstructures, and so on. The manufacturing engineer is responsible to deliver a product that can be used in a technical system and must perform in a technical system. And it is not just technology. Even in this world of new materials and new hardware and software, there are human beings involved. And therefore, a very principal question is the workplace safety. When I still was a young assistant professor at Karlsruhe University, we were the first research laboratory in Europe working with so-called whiskers. submicron size mini crystals for the reinforcement of materials. We had beautiful projects together with important industries, and from one day to the other, some governmental decisions were made and the laboratory was closed. Why? Because nobody was working on the safety standards in the handling of these powders. And you may remember that the poor Jürgen Schlichting, he died from lung cancer because he was aspirating microphones. So it is essential, before we come with these nanopowders to industrial processing, that we have safe powder handling, safe component handling, and this must not fulfill the standards of our personal laboratory, but must fulfill the standards of modern European legislation. And this means the powder should not come as a free streaming powder to the air. You need it in closed boxes, or you need it as a dispersion in a solvent, or you need it as a feedstock in a thermoplastic binder. So it is no more able to volatilize. So it is a safety bond. Okay, and then we develop the product. We have an idea of the design of the products, their functionality, and the process and the materials related, conditioning and compounding. So many chemical technologies are involved. It is much more than mechanical technologies, it's a lot of surface technologies of these ultra fine grain powders required. And then we come to the core in the manufacturing chain, that is the forming and shaping. A minute ago, I told you about the high hardness, the high strength, and the high toughness of the material. What does it mean? You cannot take this material like a traditional ceramic in a tool machine. You go to your control board, you fix a good diamond tool, and then you grind it and you finish it. Because these materials, they have a tenacity and a strength that to take away 100 microns with a diamond tool may cost you 6 hours. Nobody will pay for it. And this means completely different way of thinking for the manufacturing engineer, because we must work for forming and shaping processes where we have the component in net shape dimensions and in net shape tolerances. So we must try that the machining, the precision machining of the finally sintered or hot pressed component, that means a consolidated final product, is no more required. And this is the reason also for my talk today that we have such a strong focus on the thermoplastic binder systems, because we can employ injection molding. Not the injection molding of plastics, polymers, but the injection molding of ceramics with very well developed binder and plastifier systems. In this case, it is possible. We have the geometry of the final product. We make a super high precision tool. The tool is filled, and we have all the shrinkage and all these parameters calculated so that the product that is coming out from the sintering furnace, as far as possible, exactly fits to the requirement of the customer. And this means we have very hard work in the debindering, in the heat treatment, the sintering technologies, and what does it mean? This is chemical thermodynamics. This is the chemical kinetics of thermal processing, and this also means process automation. All the furnaces, all the equipment that is running to have a very good reproducibility. The worst thing, believe me, that can happen is that one day you have good luck and it works beautifully. Everybody is excited. You yourself, your colleague, your boss gives it to the press, and people are coming to you and say, bring me 1,000 pieces. And you cannot reproduce it. This is a disaster. Therefore, we need the academic and professional experience of the physical chemists and of the engineers, especially also in the field of automation and automized control systems. And if this works, we can fulfill the requirements from the viewpoint of material science, and we can fulfill the requirements of the viewpoint of the manufacturing engineer, and this means the manufacturing engineer is the translator of the language of the customer to the language of our factory. And for sure, we want to have a very high surface quality, and for many of these ceramics, it is essential to understand also the stress distributions. If you imagine that there is a material with a maximum sintering temperature of 1,500, 1,700 degrees C, and you cool it down to room temperature, there will never be a homogeneous stress distribution over all the wall thickness of the material. This is crucial for ceramics because they can never compensate high stresses by plastification. So now you have an idea that we need a lot of interdisciplinary expertise to fulfill the requirements. There are technological and also economical challenges in the field of nanoceramics production. Because even if we have high quality raw materials, fortunately we have commercially available powders, a few from them from Germany, more from Japan, and what do you expect? This is the most important supply source today, China. So China is no more a third world country, a country with millions and billions of people. It is also, they have a good and successful strategy also to think about advanced raw materials, something our politicians have forgotten, or as we can see in Germany, really ignored. And this is important because we need reliable sources for the raw materials, otherwise we have no chance for a well-organized production. Yes, and we have the four main steps in the processing chain, and this is not only the chronology, it is also the chain of value adding. At the beginning you have the original value of the powder and the additives and the raw materials and the energy, but the value is created in the first step by the compounding operations, second by the forming and shaping operation, then the drying, debindering and sintering, that means all the variations of the thermal processing. And last but not least, there remains a little bit on final machining, and as I mentioned earlier, we have to try to minimize these final machining efforts, but there are some cases where it always makes sense to do this. And the most prominent example is the extraterrestrial signal transformation. Yeah? You know that not only for the offset telecommunication, but for many other important computer systems, we have the communication no more earth-bonded but through satellites. And these are very, very precise mirrors, mirror surfaces that are space-based, and all these materials are made from these or similar ceramic materials. Because of the stiffness, because of the hardness, because of the low thermal expansion, you know, in space, on the sun side, you can have very high temperatures, but on the shadow side, you come close to the absolute zero. And this means a thermal stress of 300-400 degrees for such a structure. And if you need a high optical performance, you need dimensional tolerances in the nanometer size. And this was one important European project we had together with Spanish partners from Oviedo and the French Alcatel Group as the industrial partner to develop ceramic mirrors for this signal transformation. Near net shape ability for this process. And this means we have to think about every effect that may disturb the original geometry and dimension, and it makes a big difference what type of forming process has been selected. Was it casting for the ceramics? This means slip casting, gel casting, or electrophoretic deposition? Or was it a plastic forming process, especially working with thermoplastic binders, extrusion, viscous flow, ceramic injection molding, or low pressure ceramic injection molding? Or was it a pressing operation? Axial pressing in multi-level tools, or cold isostatic pressing with subsequent dry machining? So we have many alternatives, but the alternative we select must be fitted to the material's requirements. And the same is true for the sintering. Yes? If you can afford, you can employ a spark plasma sintering furnace. And if you have ever seen such a device, that is where high frequency voltage and current is passing through the material sample itself. So it's a direct type of high frequency heating where we have little plasma filaments going through the powder compact. Nice and in some cases performing, but the geometry you can achieve is just a disc, it's just a plate. Everything else must be machined out from the plate. And you also can employ microwave heat. We have powerful microwave sources where in a volume of 10 liters you can achieve a temperature of 1800 degrees C. But the question is, what is the cost and the reliability of equipment? So we in our Department of Electrical Engineering, we have a beautiful development, but finally it has about triple the investment cost of other modern sintering furnaces. And for an industrial application, the economical parameters are in many cases the decision-making point. So pressure-assisted systems have been established for all these traditional micron and submicron powders and recipes, and you can imagine an economic success will be enormous if there are intelligent and professional people that can have a system working in a way that we have the perfect consolidation under atmospheric pressure. That means pressure is from the viewpoint of an additional pressure source. And Dr. Kern, who is one of the co-authors of my talk today and leading this group, I think it took him more than 3 years, and I think it was very nice to see that it started with a very, very detailed literature study, the evaluation of the pros and cons of these authors, and then the adaptation of what they had done in laboratory size to industrial size. And this will be a part of my talk in the next few minutes. So the manufacturing of nanocomposite bulk ceramics. And we have selected the zirconia toughened alumina materials, zirconia toughened alumina. And this is an excellent material for applications in mechanical engineering, but also in chemical engineering, because of the high chemical resistivity, high strength, high toughness, but even more interesting, since recently, for biomedical devices, for processes. Hip joints, knee joints, elbows, T-joints, and this material has a very good biocompatibility in the human corpse, and it is much cheaper than the titanium alloys, for example. And as a production method, we selected the ceramic injection molding, and okay, the objective was to develop a feasible method to produce small, because of the dental application, for example, small and complex shaped CTA nanocomposites for biomedical, mechanical engineering, and further application by the near net shape process in a reproducible quality and at low cost. Yes, some of you may think, this is a typical requirement for a powerful industrial company. Yes, you're right. But if you have ever seen a German university, the structure is very different. Just two figures. The University of Stuttgart had just 24,000 students. This is a medium size, or at the larger end of the medium size university. But we have 4,900 researchers. So this is a powerful research institute. So what we are delivering to the industry is not just basic science or technology. No, as an engineering university, we give them the complete know-how so that the industrial partner has no more big risk to employ this technology. They must just pay the investment and build up the factory. So the interface between the top five technical universities in Germany and the industry is very different to some other countries. Also very different to a university in the United States. That is often a big surprise if the people come and see how we are working. And Miriam can discuss this with her personal experience later with you, just to have an idea. All the business we are doing, just 20% of the budget is paid by the state from taxpayer. In the last 2 years, we had 80% from contract work. That means, if you come and visit us, you will see the people always hurrying and working like in an industrial company. So it is not the lifestyle of a school, it is the lifestyle of an engineering company. That is a little bit different. And another important difference is the hardware we have employed. You will find a hardware that you may expect in a modern industrial company. For example, we have six big robot systems. And not because I am in love with robots, because we need them for the reproducibility. Because even the best craftsman, even the best engineering expert has his or her good days and bad days. But we need the same quality on Monday or on Friday afternoon. Okay. Let's go on with these requirements. Materials must also be affordable. Yesterday, Martin, in his talk about fiber-reinforced light levels, did show beautiful materials. But there is only one or maybe two partners in the world who can pay the famous Japanese ceramic fibers as a reinforcement. And it is the US Air Force and maybe the Chinese Air Force. Nobody will pay this in the civil industry that is under hard competition. No, we go to different markets, and just to give you an idea, we have some of the nano powders where we are in the range of 20 to 40 euros per kilogram. And this means this is no strategic drawback. We have conventional materials, if you are familiar with metallurgy, you have the scandium alloy with aluminum. Even now you pay $600 per kilogram. See, this is not a very expensive material. The forming process needs a high capacity. Not the process where you produce one component per day or per shift. And we also need a high surface quality of the final product. The sintering should be done under atmospheric conditions, and the microstructural requirements, that means the materials requirements, is a density higher than 98% of the theoretical density, and for sure we cannot accept a grain growth, a critical grain growth, because we must retain the micro-nano architecture in this type of materials. Yes, and ceramic injection molding is one of the most sophisticated manufacturing processes for advanced ceramics, but here is our expertise and we have to do a professional work. How does this process look? So, look to this flow chart. You have the original ceramic and powders. It is not one, it is two, or in some cases we have a little permanent additive, it can be three or four powders. We need the binders and additives, and we need a very precise metering, a very precise metering of the components, because in some cases we have only a tolerance of 1% or 1.5% to keep the properties. So then we have the mixing operation. The mixing operation, that means the homogenization. And then we come to the first value adding, that is the granulation. The granulation, because for the injection molding process, the final machine is fed by granulates. Okay. And then we have the forming operation, the injection molding, and the sprue separation. And if we do it in a clean way, we can not only separate it, we can also recycling this component. So if we have a really very expensive raw material involved, there is only a minimum of materials loss, so it is very effective from the viewpoint of recycling. But then again, and this is the reason why modern high technology ceramics are a field not just of engineers, especially in material science, it is clearly a field of technical chemists, because you need all the expertise from physics and chemistry, and this is essential, because all these nice binders we need to have a good form filling, And all these properties obtained, finally the binder must be taken out. Yeah? And this is not an easy operation. I would guess that worldwide, read my lips, worldwide, there are not even 20 companies who have the law. So it is a very narrow market, very narrow market. And after the debindering, which takes place in a temperature range between 100 and 600 degrees C, for example, we go to the final solidification by sintering, by pressureless sintering, and for sure we need the final measuring and checking if we have really obtained all the properties of the material, if there are the correct dimensional tolerances, there are no flaws allowed, no warping, etc. And if we have a special relationship to the rheology and to textures, we can also analyze the microstructure and texture features in our product. So this is a rough concept what has to be done in research and development for this type of material. So this is a short overview of the materials that are involved. You see, this is a nice alliance of two powders from a German supplier, one Japanese and one Chinese, and it is interesting, especially the best type of alpha alumina for these devices. You see at the big end of the nanoscale is nearly a monopoly of the Chinese. So these are the two machines. One looks very conventional, it is conventional. So there is a double blade, a double sigma blade needle, and the blades are rotating with a gap width of a tenth of a millimeter. So you have very high shear stresses and very high forces and momentum in this machine to homogenize a high viscose recipe. The batches are in the range between 4 and 15 kilograms, elevated temperatures, and finally we have an extrusion device where we obtain pellets with a diameter of 3 millimeters, and the length can be under variation from 5 to 20 millimeters. But this is just the first step, mixing and homogenization. If we employ nanopowders, we need much higher homogeneities, but we must also be careful that we have not too high amount of binder. And therefore, the so-called twin screw extrusion machines. You see, this is a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5-step extruder with two axes, with two currently running axes. And we have now the shear stress in the gap between each of these gears in comparison just to the two sigma plates here, so that the extrudate of this type of machine has the highest standards of homogeneity. So one of these screws has an external diameter of 16 millimeters, so it looks like a very small machine. And the smallest batch sizes we can handle are just a quarter of a kilogram, but it is no problem to run such a machine also for the same batch sizes from 10 to 15 kilograms. So this is the first important thing to be done, to have the know-how in the mechanical processing. Just a few words about the rheology. Right-hand side, we have the traditional plot where we have the tension over the shear rate, and you see that for three different micro-sized powders, only at very high tensions there is a small decrease, so we have more or less linear behavior. So these are the modern micro feedstocks of ceramics with primary grain sizes in the range between 1 and 10 micron, for example. So the viscosity is in the range of 10 to the 5 Pascal seconds, and only at very high shear stresses there is this drop of viscosity. For the nano feedstocks, it is a completely different behavior. Completely different behavior. The viscosity rises more or less linearly with the shear stress, and we achieve high viscosities up to 10 to the 9 Pascal seconds. So four orders of magnitude can be the difference. But on the other hand, you can see there is no sharp drop of the viscosity at high stresses. It behaves more or less linearly. So why is this so important? Not because of the mixing operation alone. It is important for the form filling behavior in the subsequent injection process. And therefore, the viscosity level and the shear stress necessary to classify the feedstocks rises with decreasing the filler particle size. And it is most important that we have an understanding for this behavior, but there is a further consequence. We cannot work with the same type of binders and additives. Because if I will not go into too much detail, but you can have an idea that if you go to the molecular dimensions of the typical binders, they are much smaller than the 10 micron powder. But they are in the same range or even larger than our nanometer powders. Not these large ones, but the small ones with 10 or 20 nanometers. And this is essential to learn about the interfaces in the feedstock to control the viscosity. So for the materials testing, for the research, as I mentioned earlier, nobody will pay for the cutting and machining and polishing for test bars. You see here, this is a typical tensile test bar, here with the square surface, a thicker one and a thinner one, or the precision rings that are tested under compression, or the traditional rectangular bar for 3-point or 4-point bending measurements. So typically we work with such a small industrial machine. 50 tons can be kept in these suspension, and we have a modern control system involved with four segments of heating, and this is hydraulic machine. The typical injection pressures go up to more than 1,000 bars. More than 1,000 bars, this is really a lot of machine performance. And you see the plastification temperature is around 150-160 degrees C. The mold under steady state conditions has about half of the temperature, and the interesting parameter is the cycle time. 10 to 30 seconds. 10 to 30 seconds. That means per minute you have 100, 200 pieces. This is essential. To be so quick and fast, and that means to be cheap. But there are problems. And in such a device, there is always an entry of the form where the material must pass through. And in some cases we have two or three entries and the flow fronts can meet. What means if the flow front meets, there is no mixture. There can be a separation where the flow fronts meet each other. Or there can be a free jet injection. In the case if we have a long bar and a non-appropriate design of the runner or of the sprue. So there is always in the background the improvement of the tooling. Even if the product looks so simple, it is so simple because we must test it under standard conditions. The product is more complicated in its size and shape. Okay, now to the high temperature side. So you see here is the relative density. And the requirement was to be better than 98% of the serine. And you see these three different raw materials, they show a very sluggish sintering behavior under atmospheric pressure. There is just one product that with very high sintering temperatures can fulfill the requirements. But to work with such high temperatures with the nanopowders is not so exciting. If we employ the nanopowders, we want to save energy because energy cost is a further important argument. We must try to find a solution to compensate this disadvantageous behavior. And this was the unique performance of Dr. Kern when he did employ his Chinese technology. It is not so easy for me as a German engineering professor to say we had to employ the basic science of China to develop the industrial technology. But maybe for the workplaces this is the better solution. And we must not worry about this because the Chinese have used so often our basic science to develop industrial capacities. So you see it is a different era of competition, also vice versa. So you see this is the test bar for the bending test, and you can see this is the macroscopic fracture and it is nearly perfect. There is no pores. There is just a slight idea that there may be some textures in the material. If we go to a very high resolution, we can see that the materials, all the three recipes are very homogeneous and fine-grained, but we also can see that there are some differences in the adhesion between the individual grains of such a microstructure. And this is for sure related to the crystal structure and to the diffusion phenomena between the species during these operations. As I mentioned earlier, it is important if we can achieve the good densification by pressureless sintering, it is for sure that we are the winner from an economic point of view. And we know we have competitors in the research field, we have competitors together with our partners in the industry. And as a very expensive material, they have alternatives. And Frank found this literature study, and what they are doing is the so-called two-step sintering, the two-step sintering. So there is a lot of physical chemical know-how behind it. You can imagine it is first something like a ripening, so that the material is pre-sintered. So we have a pre-arrangement in the crystal structure of one species. And then in the second step, we go to the maximum sintering temperature until the densification. And the surprise is that the difference of the sintering kinetics brings us in the situation that we have the final high density without the application of any high pressure device. And this was really brand new for this group of zirconia toughened alumina materials. And so there is a worldwide positive feedback to this very impressive result. So here you see just a few rough data. You see very slow heating rates, 2 kelvins per hour, and 48 hours dwell time in the window between 800 and 850 Celsius. Yes, when Frank presented these results to me, I was a little shocked when I saw this long period, but then it was clear why nobody had observed this behavior except the Chinese colleague. Except the Chinese colleague. Because he had enough time, nobody was asking him to report to any bureaucracy. He was free in his research, as we have been 50 years ago. And this effect is really a surprise. Some diffusional processes are not working in nanoseconds or minutes or hours. Sometimes they are working in many hours or days. Yes, and that's the final sintering temperature. I will show you in a second, is 1480, 1500 degrees C, with a much shorter dwell time. And here the dwell time is also related to the wall thickness. The larger the part, you must modify the dwell time. Yes, and you see this was published in 2006, and within just 1 year came to industrial practice. So this shows the different structures, the conventional sintering, and here you see this two-step sintering, so that the final material is much denser, and we have also a shift of pore sizes to the much finer side. Yes, so this change in the sintering cycle leads to dense materials with extremely fine grained structure. You see this bar is just 1 micron, and for a material that has seen around 1400, 1500 degrees C, this is really an impressive result. And again, we have a very high homogeneity, so that this was the result we could deliver to the partners, where nanocomposites with this tetragonal zirconia reinforcement were ready to go to the market. Here you see finally the different sintering behavior. These two ones for the two-stage sintering, and these ones for the conventional sintering. The same material, the same material. And this is in the community, in the scientific community, not a bad result, to have no misunderstanding. And I really must confess, I did never expect. That was the reason why nobody did go forward with the further development of the materials, that such a result would be possible. And at the very end, it was the know-how in physical chemistry, and it was the result of statistical experiment plan. So there is always a little bit inspiration, but a lot of transpiration, a lot of hard work. I will not discuss how many hours of the slaves were behind this result, so that one could realize. But with the breakthrough for this ZTA binary phase ceramics, this technology with the two-step sintering, you know, we published it in 2006, 2007, it came the first time to the international conferences. It is one of the most sensitive research fields actually in the ceramic community. Imagine such a furnace, a sintering furnace, with a useful volume of half a meter in a cube. What do you think is the investment for pressureless sintering? I give you the figure. It is around 200-250,000 euros. The same for a gas pressure furnace is 800,000. And the same for hot isostatic pressing is 1.5 million. And this is just the cost for the investment, not only the operating cost and the technical gases and so on and so on and so on. So I just want to summarize here, it is not always the question, and that was a competition with some other colleagues, that were just give me more money to the government. If you give me more money, I will be better. It's a very simple concept. It's a very simple concept. Here it was just discipline, very hard discipline, and to work with all these tools in simple kinetics that the people can learn in a good faculty for physics and chemistry. So sometimes it is not money or a big effort, it is just the use of brain, just the use of brain. Yes, and finally, just a few words. We are not only living in a turbulent world, we are also working with turbulent materials. And sometimes we use a very small amount of soot on graphite, and this is a test bar in full dimension. And look here at the turbulences. Look here at the turbulences. You have seen it in a much higher resolution with an electron microscope. It looks perfectly homogeneous, and it is homogeneous in the range of 50 or 100 micron. But this is very unusual. Think that in the microscopic scale it is homogeneous, in the macroscopic or in the mesoscopic it is not, because we have these textures. And Professor Conte knows. Since many years, we have developed a friendship to the people in technical mineralogy. And these people know a lot about anisotropy in a crystal lattice. They know how to measure it with optical methods. And if you have a material with optical anisotropy, you can employ these optical methods to measure the orientation of the textures in your material, to measure the orientation of the textures. And this can be done, for example, by the contrast of such a color illumination. So, textures, if we use plastified or fluid feedstocks, are almost unavoidable. We must live with the textures. But the question is, and now you need the mechanical engineer. The mechanical engineer from the customer side, he knows what is the mechanical load on my component. And now the manufacturing engineer must design the tool that the flow line is not contradictory to the main stress axis. That means we need additional information about the main stress axis of the final product. If I tell this to my colleagues of the Max Planck Institute, they look to me as if I would talk about color to a blind person. Because materials mechanics is not their world. They are happy if they have a beautiful material with beautiful properties and they can make beautiful publications. And I tell you very honestly, this is the traditional academic life. But if you want to have a successful career after your studies in the industry, the product must work, must be effective. Yeah. And this is such a study. You see, here we have, for a better orientation, the flow lines, and this is the orientation of the sprue design, and we can now separate the plane A, and vertically or orthogonally the plane B, and here you can see the turbulences as they develop under these different orientations. And this is another subject where at the beginning we had absolutely no experience, no idea about this phenomenon. But after 10 years of learning and working with the method, today is an important tool in the development of the material and in the development of the design of the tool. Yeah? To minimize the risk that we have the flow lines in an orientation or in a distribution where we don't want to have them. So, therefore, Jose Andres, your effort in finite element analysis, it is not just an abstract subject, it is hard work. Mm-hmm. Only very few people understand it. You are often very alone with your problems. But without your expertise and the feedback, the manufacturing engineer cannot have a first-class solution. He can just do it for an error. And I like to talk about this example to the students because it shows, even from the viewpoint of an industrial manager and an engineering professor, basic science is indispensable. We need both. We need both. And we must bring these two worlds together. And then we can have a top solution. The people will never come to success that are just looking to their little field and not what is going left and right for me. And the politicians and the journalists will never be successful because they have no expertise. This is a very good example that this is worth to work for. Yes, so the summary is that these zirconia toughened alumina nanocomposites with this micro nanostructure can be produced from commercial powders and relatively cheap submicron powders of the metric size and reasonably cheap nano size zirconia powders, feedstocks with a high solid content and a good rheological behavior were developed and employed, and the ejection molding is appropriate for small and complex shaped parts, and they can even be produced on standard ejection molding machines, so that there is no principal new investment required for the ejection molding process. This stable two-step debinding and sintering process was established and is now in practice, and so all the fundamental work has been done so that these ceramics can go to various applications. So the last thing we have now is tools, very high wear loaded tools for injection and extrusion machines, and step by step we also find the financial resources to employ further young engineers for their doctorate, for their research studies, because we don't bring this money on a Swiss bank account. We just invest it in the institute for the next generation of researchers. Okay, do you like a short break, or should I go on with the surface technology? Everybody tired?
No.
Really?
No.
Okay, so I go on.
Very interesting. Not only scientific talk, but educational point of view. This is, I think that we have to learn a lot of the orientation for the water, the shallow water in the environment. This is about example how you are going to get like the scientific patients with industrial. I talk to my colleagues always the patents in the new material that will become not only for the scientific research, but also for the application. Because what we need is the conjunction of the two manner.
Yes, and this is also important that
we are too muscular.
It is also important to talk to each other. Yeah. I think when we met the first time, the muscular people from the big fission reactor didn't understand clouds and sunshine. But you know,